In the history of the world backwards, we find at the top of society those pure-blood aristocrats who boast the longest, most noble ancestry.
I am from one of the oldest Italian families. We can trace our lineage right back to Frankie Dettori. But do you know the Galliard? The Pavan? La Volta? The Dance of the Nobility? I always assume the man of your class knows any own type of dances. The Cretan's Reel, Mary with My Pie Crust, the Shaky Cripple, the Sailor's Rash, the Lame Goose.
And the music they dance to is the tragic result of a bargain made by the last blues man, Robert Johnson, at the crossroads.
What's your problem, man? I gotta go that way.
Got a proposition for you. I'm gonna sell you a soul.
How much you charge?
Well, I was wondering, how would you feel about changing your name to David Gray?
And though humankind has moved from city to village, they have brought the old problems with them.
As I walked into Salisbury on a bright and sunny day, the meadow full of buttercups, it was the month of May. I saw a dove, a stoat and a lark, and I saw a speckled hen. But then I had a panic attack and never went there again.
We've been headed the wrong way all through time, living in the wrong place, wrong life, traveling on the wind one day, going the wrong way.
In backwards history, coal and steam power is superseded by a new age of wave and wind. Gas turbines give way to windmills, steamships to sail. Though history goes backwards, time flows forwards. Thus, the stevedore's boy who begins his life at sea shoveling coals on cross-channel ferries ends his long nautical career bosun on the quarterdeck of a three-masted ship of the line. Feudalism wins elections. The feudalists get in by focusing on local issues as barons give stump speeches in the market square.
Now, I won't lie to you, dogs. Feudal aristocracies are organizations of families set up to procure our own advantages at the expense of yours. And to do this, I tell you plainly, we're going to be using fear, violence, and big horseback barons in black with studded black gauntlets going, ha-ha, a pretty gold necklace, hag. It shall look well on my falcon. But we are planning to lift weekday parking restrictions.
Under these harsh new laws, a big V is branded on the face of vagrants, T on traitors, H on heretics, W on witches, and so on. In times of social unrest, the barons round up troublemakers and bring them into the smithy, which has a range of branding irons hanging on the wall. Here the baron sits on a stool with his prisoners and instructs the blacksmith, consonant, consonant, another consonant. This is the plague warden, his hooked beak crammed with chives and civet to ward off infection from the plague victims carried on his cart. He rings a bell and cries, "Bring out your dead." After burying 20,000 Londoners in a pit in Hyde Park, the plague warden announces that from now on he will only do fortnightly collections. He also insists that you have the dead stacked out for him on the pavement, otherwise, you know, you can forget about having your corpses collected, because it's not going to happen. Not if he's got to come right to the door, no way. The change to fortnightly collections has made the once popular plague warden a hate figure, and when he's off duty, he worries about being recognised. In an effort to boost his popularity, he tries to do some public relations, showing a sweeter side of the plague warden which people haven't seen. Bring out your dead, have a nice day.
Master,
I bring you a message from my grieving father, Chong Sat Lao. Long ago, you and he studied the deadly Wesley Snipe-style Kung Fu under Master Chen Shen. He has passed on much of his knowledge to me, his eldest daughter, but now grows old and frail. He says, you must teach me the secret technique so as to complete my training and allow me a chance to avenge the destruction of my village by the invisible hand.
No, I won't teach you snipe style. If you want to learn how to fight, you must first know the context, sociologically. The reason being, that it is wiser to use the head, not the fist. Brain, not sinew. Intelligence, not force.
Like the Incas, for example.
What do you know of the Incas?
Chung Sat taught me that the Incas evolved their own body language for please don't hurt me. Before them, the universal hand gesture of appeasement recognized in over a billion outlets worldwide was this. But the Incas thought this showed fear and was liable to incite aggressors by suggesting that they were capable of doing harm before they'd attacked you. So they evolved their own gesture of appeasement, their own body language for please don't hurt me. It is said only you, Master, know the secret of what it was.
Your knowledge is good. Yes, what the Incas would do instead is nod very slowly, as if in agreement with the aggressor, whilst walking towards them, again very slowly, non-threateningly, and all the time making welcoming gestures. Put altogether, it would have looked something like this. And they were wiped off the face of the earth. Fighting! Invisible! Hand in the north!
July the 28th, 1588. Sir Francis Drake is the early leader in the modern triathlon after the first two events, sailing and cycling. The medal glory which champion triathlete Francis Drake brings to England makes some people nostalgic for the Olympic Games, which were knocked on the head centuries ago. By 1908, the Olympics had become too demoralizing to go on. Every year, we were running slower, jumping lower, and throwing nearer. Crowds at the 1968 Olympics in Mexico booed the first ever sprint field, all to take over 11 seconds to complete 100 meters. The International Olympic Committee tried to improve performances with a series of reforms, limiting competitors only to posh people who could be relied upon not to dawdle or shirk, and insisting that athletes implement harsh new fitness regimes based on the latest scientific advances in diet and nutrition. Out went the fruit shakes and vitamin supplements. From now on, salt lost through sweat would be replaced by steak and kidney pie and chips, port baklava and suet pudding. In 1492, the looter and killer Columbus is driven off the continent of America. For Columbus, the final indignity is that the Arawak people pursue him with sarcasm. As Columbus's ship sets sail, the Arawaks follow him into the water, holding out jewels and gold and shouting, "Oh, you forgot these! Mr. Columbus, you forgot the gold!"
Mariners face a hazardous Atlantic. As a consequence of 21st century factory fishing, petrochemical tanker spills, and a toxic runoff from industrial agriculture, only three fish now survive in the Atlantic Ocean. Not three types of fish, three individual fish, three giant mutant fish that eat the rusted hulls of sunken nuclear submarines for breakfast. The giant mutant fish are the terror of mariners, and the subject of anxious sea shanties sung by fishwives when their menfolk go away to sea.
May you sail home on your ship, safe from the giant mutant fish that grew so big it ate the whale and shows up on a world map drawn to scale.
The Spain to which Christopher Columbus returns is barely recognizable and undergoing throes of change.
What is worse is that in Muslim-controlled Spain, the Arabs allow Jews freedom of worship. Arabs and Jews, their culture is not Spanish culture. Their way of life, philosophy, mathematics, gardening, architecture, poetry, washing, it is not our way. And the Arab sports. I went as a spectator to this sport called halal, I tell you, my friend. It is the most one-sided bullfight you ever seen in your life.
See, and what is more, as my ship sailed along Costa del Sol, I saw how the Arab invasion had lain waste our great historical town of Torremolinos. They had even desecrated pots, fish, and sheep. And the shamrock bar of Fuengirola.
But on the eve of Spain's final battle against the Muslims, El Cid was mortally wounded. Knowing that without the guiding light of this legendary warrior, the Spanish would lose heart and run from the enemy, with his last breath, the dying Cid gave orders that his dead body should be strapped onto his famous horse and lead the men into battle in such a way that they should not know he was dead until battle had been joined.
About Arthurian Albion.
So, you want to know about Arthurian Albion?
Yeah, tell me about Arthurian Albion.
The Arthurian Knights model themselves on the Rotarians, a charitable association of businessmen sometimes called the Round Table Society. Yes, the Knights organized pony rides for peasant children. But they also waged war against all other charitable organizations until they alone were the dominant NGO. In a particularly brutal massacre, they slew every last member of the Variety Club of Great Britain and were subsequently investigated by the Charities Commission. But they were a great warrior nation!
The Gupta dynasty in Patna, during the rule of Chandragupta, pride themselves on being the last society still to use and understand the number zero. Until one day a terrible accident befalls Gupta society. During a routine long division equation, a mathematician takes away the naught, carries the one, and can't find it again. He looks under the line, not there. He checks back through the figures, there are no zeros anywhere. And so, with trepidation, court mathematicians break the news to King Chandragupta. Your Majesty, we regret to inform you that we have lost nothing in backwards history ever since that day in Patna. The following phenomena will always cause humans to experience a strange, nameless melancholy. A woman twisting the ring on her finger, a wheel, a hoop, and the empty dog collar. We are made sad by blank domino halves. Since Patna, we also feel a strange sense of vertigo in between the now consecutive numbers 9 and 11, 19 and 21. King Chandragupta weeps into an ice cream cone topped with a chocolate flake, his tears prompted by what he calls the stranded sorrow of a 99. And didn't this come, asks Queen Chandragupta, once have a crunchy multicolored topping which was a sprinkling of many, many very tiny pieces? Oh, what were they called? What were they called? No, it's gone. Gone. Gone but not forgotten are the spectacular achievements of a war millennia ago, which is kept alive by bardic tradition.
I will tell the story of how the war on terror was won, How in the disputed territory of Iraq long ago, in the 21st century, weapons of mass destruction were removed from the hands of non-state terror organizations. This was the single greatest achievement of the war. And the story concerns Ashekili nuclear facility in a little town called Tiwatha in Iraq. No sooner did the U.S. Army assume responsibility for securing the nuclear facility south of Baghdad than Jordanian customs officers reported that one in every eight trucks crossing the Iraqi border were carrying barrels of uranium material straight back to Tiwatha's secure facility. Thanks to the decisive actions of U.S. Strategic Command in securing the Tiwatha site, the peoples of the world could at last rest easy, safe in the knowledge that there will never be a radioactive dirty bomb in a major city. If there's one thing alone which justified war on Iraq, surely it was this.
You know, for centuries, people have been talking about the prophecy of the coming of the Messiah, which is to happen when the calendars reach year zero. A schism divides believers, however. Some say that the Messiah will definitely come from Latin America. Some say only that he might come from Latin America. But all are agreed on one article of faith. The Messiah, when he does come, will have a popular Latino name.
And so it comes to pass at year zero when the calendar goes forward, a man called Jesus appears on the dusty roads leading to Jerusalem. He is a Mexican migrant worker in the olive groves who begins his career telling stories to his fellow seasonal workers.
What is your mission, Jesus?
My mission is to replace the philosophy and teachings of Paul with the philosophy and teachings of Jesus. And that, my friend, is why we are going this very day to deliver a sermon at the Mount of Olives.
Yes. Paul predicted that you would speak at the Mount of Olives.
Oh, yeah? Well, did he predict I would do this? I don't think it is in his book. I'm looking through it. I cannot see it anywhere. Perhaps it got stuck inside the pages. I'm being you now. Oh, Paul is so clever.
At the Mount of Olives, Jesus delivers his parable to a small crowd of migrant workers.
Okay, compañeros. I'm going to tell you a little story. This story happened 2,000 years ago, before the high-tech telecommunications era was lost to technology collapse, or so they say. Because, my friends, there is a theory that the technology did not collapse after all, and that if you look very closely at a painting by Constable, you can just see Albert Einstein and Alan Turing loading DVD players onto the highway. Once upon a time, long, long ago, a TV weather forecaster in America woke up to hear the same song on the radio alarm clock as I'd been playing the day before and the day before that. He began to realize he was living the same day of his life over and over again. What must he do for his days to change?
Lord, that's just the plot of Groundhog Day.
No, it starts like that, but then it gets different because, you see, his girlfriend has blue hair and he doesn't realize that he went out with her when it was red, because he's had his memory wiped of ever having gone out with her, and she has had her memory wiped of ever going out with him. Imagine the confusion.
Lord, that's just the plot of Eternal...
No, because they're in Africa, where a drug company is experimenting on all the little kids.
Lord, that's just the plot of...
Because then he realizes he's the president of Uganda's doctor, and then he remembers, oh yeah, she used to have red hair. The song on the radio becomes different because he's got his memory back. And from then on, he's a nicer TV weather forecaster.
And so it came to pass that Jesus began to lose the audience a bit.
The end.
Oh, I've got another story. Actually, I should have begun with this other story.
He decided to jack in telling parables and to spend more time on carpentry instead. Before too long, his carpentry business thrives so well he gains confidence to have a second go at telling parables. This time his stories are enriched by experience. This time he has something to write about. He has found his own voice.
Compañeros, I'm going to tell you all a little story. Once upon a time, a carpenter was commissioned by a rich merchant to make a chest of drawers with chamfered edges. Now the carpenter did not steam the wood first of all. Don't ask me why, he just didn't. Maybe he went crazy in his mind. So he had to do extra planing to get the drawer to sit on the runners. It came to pass, the carpenter presented the merchant with a handsome chest of drawers. The merchant was very pleased and paid the carpenter well. But my friends, that winter was a damp winter. And because he never steamed it, the wood began to warp. And the drawers became quite difficult to open and to close.
What does it mean, Jesus?
Mean? Well, steaming the wood first, that is good. That is like doing good things, like visiting your mom or helping out with charity and that. Whereas the man who does not steam his wood, that's like bad things, like doing bad, like, I don't know, swearing or killing people, lying, war. Also, there's a practical layer to the story for anyone about to make a furniture purchase. Always a good idea to inquire whether the wood has been steamed or weathered prior to assembly.
When the olive picking season is over, Jesus gets a job hiring out deck chairs by the Sea of Galileo. He leaves in closed season on a pleasure beach donkey. It is autumn and fallen palm leaves blot the street, so no one hears them clip-clop out of town at dawn.
If there was one contraption from the olden days that you could bring back, what would it be?
When I was a young man, before I became a monk, I found myself in love and courting my young lady. How I wished then we'd lived in our ancestors' more romantic time of texting. Two hearts communicating instantly, no time for vows. Thumbs on prayer beads always answered. Imagine.
I wish I'd lived in the days of printing.
I remember the day we lost the printed page. That was one of the great body blows to human life. Caxton and Gutenberg had managed to extend the technology a few more days. There was much discussion as to what should be the content of the last printed page. How do you end the greatest conversation the world has ever known? In the end, it was decided it should be a picture story concerning Protestant monk Martin Luther. Well, I remember that day when the last page was posted.
Yes,
Just like the Incas and the Arthurian Albion NGOs, we in my father's village were too weak to fight the power. But where are the great warriors fighting in the east?
Yes, you want to know who will avenge the destruction of your village. That, my child, is us. We are the warriors of the East. But now the time has come for you to learn our history and our task. We were born out of the 80,000 riots and protests a year in 21st century China. Later, our order resisted the personality cult of Chairman Mao.
Blue and green should never be seen except upon an Irish queen.
Her whole family and her village.
Mao created the conditions for Chiang Kai-shek, for communism leads always to capitalism. But we are fighting both monocultures and seek instead to break up China into a loose federation of autonomous communities.
But then China will cease to be a great nation.
What does great nation mean to a peasant scything barley dawn to dusk for a bowl of soup a day? Strong nation, weak nation, what does it matter to the people?
But if we're not a big, strong nation, the Japanese will invade and make us work in fields, scything barley, dawn to dusk, all for a bowl of soup a day.
Ha! So what difference does it make?
What difference? A great difference. This will be soup with no delicious, knuckly, chickeny bits in it. It'll be that miso shit. That just doesn't fill you up. It's practically a drink.
Have you tried stirring the vegetable barley sediment at the bottom first?
Stir what you like. There's no delicious, chickeny, knuckly bits in it.
But Japan is being broken up by the shogun. We, too, must fragment China into little pieces, away from the stranglehold of the Qin Dynasty.
And then the peasants can control the ingredients of their own wonton, make their own soup in their own way. 7-hour crock pots, croutons and coriander on a surface bobbing with chickeny, knuckly bits. Is this what you mean, Master?
Soup, soup! Who knows? Who cares? We can leave all that to the invisible hand of the free...
Fighting invisible hand in the east.
In the next and final episode, we shall be taken to the sunset of recorded time. There we may glimpse traces of ourselves in these, our last descendants.
Well, aren't we skin of rabbit?
Women multitask, men do one thing.
Yeah, sit on man arms.
It's just natural and ancient. Comes from hundreds of thousands of years ago, when man would have been watching the television to check and see that the world was safe from attack, that there are no floods or unsolved crimes.
We shall see the Buddha begin to find the spiritual life a hollow sham, lacking meaning. And we shall join Mexican migrant worker Jesus, once more losing the crowd with his carpentry-themed parables.
And he had to build a gate-leg supporting bracket, whole new palabra. True story. True story.
Come on, people. Let's go listen to the better parables with more truth in them from other holy men.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. See ya.
And Rob's back next Tuesday at 11. Storyville is next tonight with another birthday double.